get the solutions. Come on in, have a seat. If you haven't been able to find a seat, I have great sympathy on these standers. There's a few seats scattered here in the first two rows. Folks are raising their hand from the crowd to show empties, so please do come in and have a seat. Okay, I'm very pleased to welcome you back and welcome you to our panel on solutions. It's my conviction that solutions are at hand, that it's nearer than we think. The United States, the genius of the United States in its three-century history has been that every time the country has been faced with a crisis, every time, we've risen to meet the crisis. We don't always do that great in between crises. We sometimes drift a little bit, but we never fail to meet those enormous existential challenges. And what you've heard here so far today is that the campaign finance situation is the latest in the series of those crises. And just as the video, Senator Bradley put it very, very eloquently, just as the civil rights revolution on racial issues was thought to be insoluble and inconceivable, suffrage and women's rights, how can we possibly solve that problem? The great wars of the 20th century, the situation was far more dire. And yet every time we've risen to the occasion, this panel is focused on how we can do the same for this crisis, viewing it as the most fundamental one today that goes to the heart of our democracy. On the panel, to address possibilities on the national level, we have Fred Wertheimer, my friend, the founder and president of Democracy 21, and John Bonifaz, the co-founder and president of Free Speech for People. They'll speak to solutions at a nationwide level. They'll be followed by a state legislative perspective. Dan Wolf, the chair of the Committee on Steering and Policy of the Massachusetts State Senate, a Democrat, and Roger Katz, the chair of the Government Oversight Committee of the Maine State Senate, a Republican, will speak about experiences in their state and the explosion, really, of energy and solutions that are taking hold at the state and local level around the country. And then finally, because we've heard again and again about the importance of the judicial perspective, the importance of the judicial branch, Justice Kennedy's own statement, the swing vote in Citizens United, that the system is not working as it should be. It's another lesson of American history that Supreme Court decisions seem like they're written in stone until suddenly they're not. And it's merely a question of one vote changing and bringing along the other four justices who were opposed to the decision in Citizens United to reverse this travesty of jurisprudence that the court wrought. So we'll hear from two judges to speak about the situation in their states, and that's Justice Alan Loughry, Justice of the Supreme Court of Appeals of West Virginia, and Justice Cheri Beasley, Associate Justice, North Carolina Supreme Court. And then finally, we'll have our interveners, Bruce Fried, the founder and president of the Center for Political Accountability, Lucas Welch, the executive director of the Pluribus Project, and Dan Berger of the Berger and Montague firm and the Progress Project. So, without any further ado, Fred, over to you. Turn on your mic, please.
In 1974, when the presidential public financing system was enacted, we almost passed congressional public financing. We passed it in the Senate, lost in the House by 47 votes. I was the campaign finance reform lobbyist for Common Cause, and I thought, this is easy. We will have congressional public financing by the end of the 1970s, and then I can go figure out what else I want to do. Well, here we all are today. For most of those who work on campaign finance reform, public financing of elections remains the most important legislative reform. And there has been progress made in the states on this issue. New York City has a model that is used by many. There are other important reforms. My thoughts on this are contained in an op-ed I published on Huffington Post today that outlines a reform agenda. Those who believe no serious campaign finance reform bills can be enacted today are right. But those who believe that these reforms can never be enacted are wrong. History is very clear here. In the 1970s and 1990s, we had major scandals, and they were followed by major reforms. We are going to have major scandals again, and we are going to have opportunities for major reforms. With this corrupt campaign finance system, it is only a matter of time before the scandals really break out. The American people are clearly ready for change. The largest national reform movement in decades now exists, and it's growing rapidly. I'd like to address the rest of my brief remarks to one very important way to fix this system without legislation and without the need for the support of the Supreme Court, and it's the use of technology. Technologies have made disruptive and revolutionary changes in virtually every sector of our society. They can do the same thing for campaign finance. I've got a paper in the back for those of you who want to see the work we're doing on this. We're working with a fellow named Joe Rosbars, the founder of Blue State Digital, who headed the effort for Obama that raised $1 billion from 8 million donors online. We think that you can make revolutionary breakthroughs in technology, and that is worth spending an awful lot of time. It's a way for dramatically increasing the role of ordinary Americans in this country, and we don't have to go through the friendly Congress right now to do it. Without a new role for ordinary Americans, the dominance of big money over our political system is simply going to grow. And what's happening in this election is extraordinary. We've never seen anything like it in history. It's billionaires of the world unite. Thank you.
John.
Thank you, Norm. I will focus my remarks on two critical solutions, both of which are necessary for ending the big money dominance of our political process and for reclaiming our democracy. First, we must press for a 28th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, which overturns the Supreme Court's rulings in Citizens United and Buckley v. Valeo, and which allows for campaign spending limits in our elections. And second, we must advance a new jurisprudence on money in politics, which lifts up the fundamental promise of American democracy, political equality for all. Since our launch in January 2010, Free Speech for People has been leading the work on both of these fronts. We also support all the solutions Fred has just outlined, including public funding of elections. But as important a reform as public financing is, it will not fully address the continued threat posed by today's regime of unlimited campaign spending. In the current post-Citizens United landscape, any system of public financing is now threatened by the targeted and unlimited spending of outside groups. No one has a First Amendment right to drown out other people's speech. A 28th Amendment allowing for campaign spending limits would ensure that big money interests may not drown out the voices of everyone else in the political process. Since the Citizens United ruling, 16 states, more than 650 cities and towns, and more than 150 Republican officials across the country have joined the call for a 28th Amendment. And in September 2014, the U.S. Senate held an historic vote with 54 senators voting in support of this constitutional amendment. We have done this before in our nation's history, 27 times before, seven of those times to overturn egregious Supreme Court rulings. We have amended our Constitution to defend our democracy and to expand our democracy. We can and we must do it again. And while we build this amendment movement, we must also build a new jurisprudence which moves beyond the purported free speech rights of the wealthy to the equal protection rights of all of us. Today's campaign finance system operates as an exclusionary wealth primary, inconsistent with the Equal Protection Clause and the promise of political equality for all. We need a new jurisprudence which is grounded in that basic promise. Now, there are those who say it just cannot be done, that it is impossible to enact a 28th Amendment and to create a new jurisprudence. But let us remember the words of Nelson Mandela, who said, "It always seems impossible until it's done." The growing movement to reclaim our democracy is on the right side of history.
So this will be different because I'm not a politician, or I haven't been for a long time. I'm not a lawyer, and I'm not a judge. So just real quickly, I grew up at a dining room table. My mother was an American history professor at the University of Pennsylvania. My dad, a business person. As a mechanic and a pilot, I started an airline. I have three daughters. They were growing into a world that I was becoming increasingly uncomfortable with as the world that would be our legacy. And so 7 years ago, I decided I was going to run for office. What an eye-opener. I come from a background where when I walk through the maintenance hangar at my airline, I look at a mechanic and think that person should have just as much political power in a democracy as I should have as a CEO of the company. This morning I started at our ticket counter at the Boston airport, and our baggage handlers, she should have as much power as I have as a CEO of the company, and we are so far away from that. And this dialogue today reminds me of the old joke, how many therapists does it take to change a light bulb? Well, the light bulb has to want to change. My concern about trying to drive the solutions through the political system is we have a political system that is now loaded with people who are in the political system because they're comfortable with doing business this way. It has been generationally long enough so that we have attracted the wrong people. And to expect those people to change without a cultural change in the system is going to be really challenging. So to see what Massachusetts is doing, go online, because I'm going to throw out a radical thought for you. An individual who I probably could not agree less with on every issue, a guy named Grover Norquist, who is actually on the other side of the political extreme. However, if there's one thing that's working, it's the pledge he's made, the no new net tax pledge, which in my opinion has gone a long way to shutting down our government relative to investments in the future. That notwithstanding, it has been successful relative to changing the culture among a lot of the Republicans, especially in our political system. I would submit that we should get the 10 or 20 best, smartest people on campaign finance and on achieving the goals that we're trying to achieve into a room and come up with a pledge that we can ask politicians, both those running for office and those in office, to make relative to how they will conduct themselves during the campaign and how they will conduct themselves in office. And I would submit, and this is a little oxymoronical, if you will, that we need to raise some money so that those who are unwilling to agree to, let's call it, democracy's promise, get unelected or don't get elected in their first campaign. Because we are not going to change this easily from the inside out. A constitutional amendment, I agree, we need to do it. Legal changes both at a state level and at a federal level, I agree, we need to do it. But we need to work on changing the culture. And some of that will be sticks and some of it will be carrots. But I think this group embodied in this room has the intelligence to come up with a pledge and to get out there, hit the streets, using technology as a leverage point, because that's a technology that we have that's new to us, and force our political leaders to agree to conduct that is worthy of our democracy, that is worthy of the mechanic on our hangar floor and the baggage handler, not just the CEO of our airline. Thanks.
Good afternoon. I'm Roger Katz. I'm a state senator from Augusta, Maine, a Republican, and a frequent consumer of his airline, by the way. And I'm here with my colleague John Brodigan from the state of Maine, who authored the referendum I'm going to tell you about in just a second. But I just want to tell you that John gave me some good advice when I first ran for office. He said you can fool some of the people some of the time, and those are the ones you should concentrate on. It's worked out pretty well so far. So as you may have heard, Maine just did something which I think is important. We're one of the small laboratories of America. We have passed a public financing law in 1996, which essentially provides public financing for House and Senate members, candidates. You have to just get a whole bunch of $5 contributions, and you can get for a senator up to $25,000 or so in public financing. And that system worked pretty well, because it provided for matching funds to those same candidates if your privately financed opponent went out and outspent you, or if a bunch of independent expenditures came in against you. But after Citizens United, that matching fund part of it was thrown out as being interfering with free speech. And guess what happened? The participation level in clean elections went down and down and down. So a bunch of bright people in Maine, including John, put together a referendum question which just passed this past fall, which attempts to deal a little bit with the increasing negative impact of money in politics in our state. And it does three things primarily. The first one it does, it allows you to go out and get more than the initial base amount of money if you get more and more and more $5 contributions. So, for instance, as a state senator now, I have to get 175 $5 contributions to get to $25,000. But if I get all the way up to 435 $5 contributions, I can get as much as $60,000 and run a good race against the privately financed candidate. And numbers in Maine are a little lower. The second thing that the referendum does is to increase the penalties for interfering with our campaign finance law and violating it. The penalties have been so low that it's essentially just been a cost of business for people from outside who wanted to come in and violate our laws. That's important. And the third thing we did is to copy, I think, what's done in some states, and to say in any campaign for a candidate that if there is outside money that comes in, they must identify in each of their ads, radio, TV, or print, their three top donors. It's getting at least a little bit at the issue of transparency, so we'll have a better idea of knowing who's financing these campaigns. And I think it was a very good referendum we're going to put into place now, but it really is nibbling around the edges, because that's about all we could do given the Supreme Court case. So I am so excited to hear about the idea of changing the Constitution, or hear again about it and hear about things that are going on elsewhere, because it's only those kind of fundamental things which are really going to change things. I mean, right now, a guy last campaign said, you know, my $5 makes me a player in our political system. That's not true now. All right, thank you.
You know, I feel like one of the presidential candidates, there's so much to say on this, and the debate the other night, I want to say, give me 30 more seconds, please. There's so much, and so many of the comments echoed earlier were so important. Let's step back a bunch of years. I'm a six-year-old kid. I'm fascinated with politics. I'm not exactly sure why, but I know that it's something very important. Wind the clock forward. I was a direct aide to a governor. I worked for a United States congressman. I was a senior assistant attorney general. Some of those people, wonderful individuals, not saying otherwise, but I got to see the system in a much different way, and instead of being fascinated, I became very frustrated. So that culminated in this book that I put together. I looked at my state's history in West Virginia from 1861, 2 years before statehood, until now, and looked at it very critically. I put the blinders on. As somebody said earlier, I'm an equal opportunity offender. I don't care what you're registered. And went into this idea of vote buying and corruption in early years until now, with the massive amounts of money that pour into political campaigns. And I put this book together. Senator Robert C. Byrd and Senator John McCain wrote the forewords. Democrat, Republican, Senator Byrd, who was always against amending the Constitution except for one example, and that was the amendment that was discussed. So I put this together. I told my wife. I mean, I really slammed some people. It was just an honest look at this. And I said, we may need to move out of the state, but I certainly will not be able to participate in politics in any meaningful way. Let's jump back to 2004. A coal operator put $3.5 million into the campaign for somebody running for our Supreme Court and against another candidate. That individual won the election. That individual sat on a case where there was an $85 million turnaround in that case. So because of that, our state put in a public funding program. I was the first person to participate in that. I qualified. I raised the donations, as you're discussing. I ran against literally millions and millions of dollars, and I won an election. I mean, this is supposed to be about solutions and writing the book and talking with others and people. I do think people are frustrated. They feel jaded, disappointed, but mainly they feel helpless at the end of the day. And I'm telling you, there are avenues to reform. I have 30 seconds left. I'm just going to jump over here and switch gears for a second to the matching funding. When I qualified for this funding, the individuals who wanted this bill passed actually had me in federal court trying to knock down part of our law, which dealt with the funding. My time's about out. If we have questions, I want to address that. I think my point is, I think there's a way that this can still be utilized when it comes to judicial elections, even though you're not going to be able to use it when it comes to other elections. So there's still possibilities out there.
In North Carolina, all judges are elected, and candidates for the North Carolina Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court run statewide elections. In 2006, North Carolina started a public financing program, and really, that's sort of a misnomer because it really was an assessment of $50 for each licensed attorney in the state that sort of created this fund, and then, of course, there was checkoff money available. But that was really how the elections for the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Courts were financed. At 2012 was the last time for a six-year period, we had public financing. My Supreme Court race was in 2014, which means there was no public financing. 2014 was my fourth election. I had two as a state trial judge. I had one for the North Carolina Court of Appeals where I did have public financing in just the same way that Justice Loughry described. You raise a little bit of money, the state or that fund will match, and it was successful. In 2014 for the Supreme Court, I didn't have that option. And so it meant calling folks and trying to raise money for an election. I heard Representative Israel before talk about the CT term, call time. And so while I was balancing the work of the court, often reading at 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, there's no other way to raise money from folks other than to make phone calls. And there are a finite number of people who are interested in appellate judicial races. Most lawyers, frankly, don't care because they don't practice before the appellate courts. And so it is very difficult. The fact that we're even having this discussion here today is so impressive because most people, even in our respective states, don't even know that they're electing judges. And they may know about the trial court judges, but they certainly don't know who the candidates are for the Supreme Court, and they don't have an idea of what's hanging in the balance. Let me say this. In 2014, $1.2 million was spent in Supreme Court races in North Carolina. There were four candidates on the ballot, and that money was spent on two of us, okay? About $500,000 of that money was spent on me. I was specifically targeted. And for all of the races across the country, it was mostly women who were targeted. So the outside money that in my race was spent by the Republican State Leadership Committee, but let me be clear, this is not a partisan issue. This is about judicial independence. It's making sure that we do have fair and impartial courts, and the money, of course, is spent, and they're candid about it, making sure that they take over state Supreme Courts so that they follow their agendas. Well, there's something wrong with that. And so we've got to be reticent and making sure that our judges, in fact, are fair and impartial and not beholden to anybody who's willing to pay money for their decisions.
So when you start to assemble the threads of this tapestry of change that we're trying to weave, whether it's the power of small donors that we've seen revolutionize and energize campaigns, the history of getting things done as tough as it seems through constitutional amendments, when you have the energy at the grassroots that we've experienced today at every point on the political spectrum, the things that have worked, the progress that has been made at the state level, the demonstrable programs that have a positive effect, the over 600, there are over 600 state and local government bodies that have spoken out objecting to Citizens United's. 14 states have endorsed or are moving towards endorsing the constitutional amendment. When you hear this array of possibilities, you see how the threads could start to come together to make this possible. Now, as we go to questions, when we go to questions from the audience, we're going to push on the propositions that all of you have put forward. We're going to test them. We're going to lean on you to think about what are the additional ingredients that are needed to catalyze these promising elements into change. But before we do that, I want to call on our three interveners who have additional insights of values, of value, things that are making a difference in other aspects of the political system and in the business world, calling on Bruce Fried to describe some of the things he's done.
Can I come up there and do that?
If you like.
That was easier. Thank you.
Norm, thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be with all of you today. What I wanted to do is bring a different perspective to dealing with the solutions of money in politics and reining in the money that is flooding the system today. We really need today to be innovative and look outside the political system and the regulatory system. And I want to talk about an approach that the Center for Political Accountability has been taking that uses corporate governance as an instrument to engage companies and to achieve disclosure and accountability of their political spending. This is with corporate funds, and it involves much of the money that goes in for dark money. Why is focusing on companies so important? Because they're the biggest spenders. According to Open Secrets, when you look at their figures, business outspends the second largest spender, labor, by 15 to 1. So you really have a preponderance of money. This would be at the congressional level, at the state level, that comes in from corporations. Now, a great deal of that money is not disclosed and is not required to be disclosed. But what the Center for Political Accountability has done in working with our shareholder partners is use the corporate governance process, engaging companies through shareholder resolutions and through dialogue to adopt disclosure and accountability policies. That has taken off. The center has an index. It's called the CPA-Zicklin Index. We've been doing it for 5 years. This last year, 2015, we did the entire S&P 500 and found that over 300 companies have some level of political disclosure and accountability. It means that we have found that a quarter of the S&P 500 have a policy on giving to 501c4s. Either they disclose if they give or they don't give to C4s. And C4s are really a major source of the of dark money. You also have disclosure of trade association payments, the portion of company payments that are used for non-deductible or political spending. There's been the companies today that are not engaging, that do not engage in disclosure and accountability are really the outliers. We have found that through the calls that we get through companies, through the work that we do on the CPA-Zicklin Index. I think what's very important is that companies have come to recognize that political spending poses a risk. They are taking actions to address this. And, you know, I think what is very significant is that this is being done within the confines of Citizens United. So Citizens United really does not block all approaches to reform. There is a great sphere that's very important that needs to be addressed. I think, you know, there's a strong foundation that has been built in this area that needs to be built upon to be able to achieve further success. But it's an important lesson that you need to be creative and innovative to achieve results which I think we have shown that we have been able to do, and that is a lesson for others. So thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you.
If the 20 VIPs who we've already had speak here today can all remain exactly within their three-minute limits, how hard can it be to change campaign finance in America? Lucas, come on up and tell us what the Pluribus Project has been working on.
Well, so I like a theme that I'm pleasantly refreshed to hear on this table of really looking, I forget the exact terms that Bruce used, but to look at a broader sphere. I think there are a number of different levers we need to be looking at. And I'll start with echoing something that Fred talked about, that we are living in a time of profound disruption where every sector in our society is undergoing profound shifts in how they do their business. And so I think it's important that we think about how can we leverage that potential to the ends that I think brings us all together here. And Fred talked about one very important part in terms of how do you generate the revenue for your campaign. And certainly the potential of broad grassroots fundraising, I think, is a critical component of that. I'd like to talk a little bit about what is the money good for? Why do you need the money in the first place? Let's be clear, these people aren't getting rich off of the funds they're raising for their campaigns. They have goals to achieve, and the logic is that financial capital is the means to achieve those goals. Well, I think that it's important that we recognize that one of the trends that we're seeing in the internet is that's not necessarily always the case. In fact, there are many instances in which having human capital is a much more effective way, if organized and leveraged properly, to achieve those goals. So let's think about, for example, today, still the single largest expense is television advertisements. Now, tell me that in 10 years, when millennials are the dominant potential voting bloc, that television ads are still going to be the single largest expense in campaigns. Of course not. Now, so the conventional thinking is that money's just going to move online. There'll be a bunch of micro-targeted ads going to reach millennials online. Now, think that a recent industry study showed that 41% of millennials have browser-based ad blockers installed on their computers. Okay? And that's growing at an annual rate about 50% a year. They're not seeing those ads. Now, what they are paying attention to is ads that's shared with them by their friends, by people they trust. And think about what that does to the incentive structure, the carrots and sticks of a campaign. If you think, if I want to reach my target demographic, I can spend all that money if I want, but that's not going to get my message in front of people. What will is if I have friends or I have people, a diversity of people, that I can count on to help share my message with those friends. Now, that's just one hypothetical example of what we see as a broader area of potential innovation. And I think this is important that we begin to think about how can we really game this system, whether that involves a pledge-based model that not only asks the candidate to make a pledge, which I think would be great, but asks citizens to make a pledge. That, yeah, I am going to install an ad blocker. My political opinion is not for sale. And instead, what I'm going to do is share content that resonates with me. I'm going to give $10 to a local media station to make earned media more important than paid media. But I think it's important that we look broader at how we can help change the way the game is played so we can help cultivate a viable way for a candidate who has strong social networks to translate that into effectively achieving their campaign objectives and mount a competitive campaign. So, thank you,
Lucas. Okay. Dan Berger.
So I'm Dan Berger, and I'm a co-sponsor of this program along with Brookings. And it's really been a pleasure to hear such an enlightened and enlightening discussion of this very serious issue. And we've heard many excellent suggestions to the campaign finance problem, and they take a number of forms. They're judicial suggestions of judicial action, suggestions of legislative action, suggestions as to actions that administrative agencies could take, and we also got an exceedingly thoughtful and original suggestion that grassroots organizing could take place at relatively low cost to deal with this issue. But I think the bottom line really is political. It's electoral. It's a question of winning elections. And the reason why I say that is that judicial modification would involve overturning Citizens United. That's probably going to require one or possibly two new Supreme Court justices. That's obviously political. Legislatively, you need a supermajority or a majority in Congress and even a supermajority to pass legislation addressing this issue, let alone the 28th Amendment to the Constitution. Hopefully it would be the 28th and not the 31st or the 35th. It would take so long to do it. At the agency level, I think you would also need to change the composition and structure of these agencies. So, you know, what is the political situation? And possibly in the next segment of the program, we'll hear why the political situation underlying change is not as dire as everyone thinks. So there clearly has to be a realignment. And I think the idea of a referendum or a referendum-type approach to this, as has been hinted at or suggested by various people throughout the day, might be a way to go. There was a suggestion that the culture needs to change, and that would imply a mass movement, and it would have to be a grassroots movement to change the overall milieu and thinking on this particular subject. So I think you would then want to ask, well, how could a grassroots amendment or cultural change amendment be financed? And but seriously, there are some ideas along those lines. We've given thought to the idea of how you would, you know, finance. We've done it in the context of progressive ideas, politically progressive ideas, which would involve going to the, you know, the progressive elements of the oligarchy, the 10 to 15% of the oligarchy, and raising the money from them because, you know, billionaires, they don't get up in the morning every day, look themselves in the mirror and say, I'm only doing this for the money. Not all of them do that. There's 10 or 15% that don't do that, and they actually want to make the world a better place. So that's a possibility. But this issue, because it is does cut across partisan lines, might actually have a bipartisan appeal, so it might expand the pool of money that would be available to fund that type of movement. So those are my thoughts.
Thank you, Dan. Okay, I'll ask everybody in the audience to get their tough questions ready for our panel and our interveners. John Putner, are you here? Okay, do not see John. When he comes back in, I know he wanted to say something. I'm going to ask Mike Peabody to say a word. But first, I'll exercise my prerogative as the chair of the panel to put a couple of tough questions of my own to just a couple of the panelists. Fred, what about Meredith's tough question? She's going up on the hill. She's not feeling the traction, despite the grassroots energy that we've heard about and seen today on the right. She's not feeling the bipartisan love when she goes on the Hill, and others of us who travel up there feel the same way. Privately, some members will tell you, both parties will say, well, I'd like to do something, but I'm concerned about leadership. How can we get more members to come out and make this truly bipartisan at the federal level on the Hill, Fred?
Well, historically, there's always been bipartisan support at the national level for reform legislation. And the reform bills that have passed have always passed with Republican leaders as well as Democratic leaders and with Republican votes. never with a majority, but a third of the Republicans, a fifth of the Republicans. For the past 6, 8, 10 years, we have not been able to get a single Republican to co-sponsor a bill, not a single Republican. We had a couple of Republicans who co-sponsored a disclosure bill in 2010 in the House. One of them lost his race for the Senate. We have a leader on the Hill who is Senator McConnell, who's been the leading opponent of campaign finance reform for 30 years, who has made a concerted effort to make sure that no Republican supports this. This is going to change when the political dynamic in the country changes. It's not going to change from the inside. It is going to have to change from the pressures from citizens, from the demands from citizens. The New York Times did a poll that showed that 75% of self-identified Republicans support greater disclosure by outside groups than we currently have. And we don't have a single Republican vote in Congress for that. The polling is overwhelming here. 79%, 78% across the ideological spectrum support overturning Citizens United. 80% support fundamental change or completely revising the campaign finance laws. So it is out there. There is not a consensus about what to support. But the anger out there and the concern is as deep as we've seen in a long, long time. And the trick is going to be how to channel that concern and that anger into pressure on Washington. We can't underestimate the fear of Republicans about being primaried by Tea Party people because they took one step over the line. That is a driving force up there right now. We can't do this from the inside right now, but it can be done. I mean, as I mentioned and as Norm mentioned, every time we've had major scandals, we've been able to fight for major reforms. And it is impossible that we will not have major scandals out of this system that's playing out right now. So this work has to be done around the country. People are working in the states to pass legislation at the state level. People are organizing at the national level. It will take time, but it will be done.
On that political disconnect, I'm going to call on two others, starting with Roger, who's there in the states. You've heard what Fred said needs to be done. There's a gap between the grassroots and the leadership. So I'm going to press you, because that's the point of this panel, Roger, actual solutions. What's the concrete, practical solutions that can help that gap be jumped?
Well, I guess I've got to agree with Fred, because once you get elected, I'm a Republican state senator, we're in the majority, and that means I get to be a committee chairman. I like being a committee chairman. And the only way I stay a committee chairman is if we remain in the majority in the 2016 elections. So once you get there, there is a tendency to start looking at things a little bit differently. And when you realize that the Republican Senate PAC, their mission in life is to elect 18 out of 35 state senators so that we will all maintain our chairmanships, frankly, you start to look at things not quite the same way. So the pressure does have to come from the outside. There's a reason that this campaign finance, this public financing referendum I just talked to you about was passed by referendum, and that's because it wasn't capable of being passed in the legislature, because leadership and, frankly, a good part of the rest of us didn't see it in our self-preservation to do it. That's the unfortunate reality of the situation, but it's got to be. I'm a real opponent of government by referendum, and we're getting that way in Maine more and more, it seems. But I agree that that's how it's going to come.
So you've given us one concrete solution, which is a referendum, a bipartisan referendum strategy in the state that channels some of this anger, not only leads to direct change, but also sends a message to Washington. I'm going to call on my friend John Pudner, to address this question. John, what can we do to change the situation so instead of getting primaried from the right because you support campaign finance reform, you're primaried because you don't? And also, would you, our friend Richard Painter wanted to say something, and he's given you some remarks to share with the group. So you've got the mic, John.
One misconception I think needs to be addressed is that the Tea Party or Freedom Caucus are more resistant to campaign finance reform than other Republicans. I can tell you, walking the hall, that's exactly the opposite. I mean, a lot of these members feel like their primary opponents are big money opponents that have squelched them. And so this is an interesting left-right coalition, I think, on some issues. You can go issue by issue. We were told when we started to take back our republic that no Republican office would meet with us. We started making calls, and 2 weeks later, we had 22 meetings in 3 days with Republican offices. In every case, though, it wasn't just us calling. We made sure they'd heard from 10 or 15 key constituents, and constituents who'd been with them on a bunch of other issues. You need like-minded constituents telling a member, no matter where they are on the spectrum, that, hey, I've been with you on six other things. I've helped on your campaign. I've knocked on doors. I've given money, whatever. And I mean, small contributions, as we're talking money in politics. But, and this is an issue you have to address. That's the old, you know, man bites dog that he tells about in journalism. You know, if the conservative goes to someone who's been beating them up on issues, you know, for six past elections, then they tell them about campaign finance reform. It's not going to move the needle. So we saw that too. And it was an interesting moment for us at May the Hill. And if you look at the co-sponsors, even on our first bill, H.R. 4177, Freedom Caucus members signed it first. They were the first ones on the bill. So it's a very interesting dynamic there. And I would say, just to once again come back to Dr. Painter's book, he spends a chapter in that on basically why every type of conservative should be concerned about this. He walks through social conservatives fighting entertainment industry or legalized drugs. He goes through libertarians, not wanting the exploitation of, you know, there's a different angle, and I think it's interesting to just go through that. And this is how we've built at least getting in the door. Now, we're at first base, don't get me wrong, but we've had good discussions, and at least, yes, we want to sponsor some things, and here's a bill we'd like to start with.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Okay, with that, I open it up to the many hands, which I already see flying up in the audience. And we're going to take the questions two at a time again. We'll start with this gentleman over here, and then we'll jump the aisle to that gentleman there.
Thank you. My name's Peter Gluck, and I have a question for Fred Wertheimer. Could you be a little bit more specific about the kind of scandal you have in mind? Because... No, seriously, if two brothers spending $869 million on the current election cycle isn't a scandal, I don't know what is.
Well, you're absolutely right.
Hold on, Fred. We're going to take two questions at a time. Over here, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Larry Checo with Accountability Central and inequality.org. And I guess I'm very heartened by this whole discussion, that serious people are really talking about this issue. But I would like to get a better read. I'd like to see where the needle is. I've asked offline one person who's up there, and they thought that there was no hope that Citizens United could be overturned. I've asked others, and they said it looks likely. How does this panel feel about it? Is it 50-50, 60-40? I would just like a needle here someplace. Can we look forward to change, or are we just kidding ourselves?
All right, so I'm going to put a sharp point on that just to get the whole panel involved. I have an idea about the kind of scandal, first of all, that it would take. But I'm going to ask, we're just going to quickly go down the panel. What kind of scandal, limit our panelists to a very short answer. Is it, if it's not enough that you have the enormous amounts of money, what kind of scandal would it take to make change? And we'll start with Justice Beasley and go down, ending with Fred.
You're probably going to be a little disappointed in my answer because that's not really my focus. My focus really is the judiciary, and it's up to really wonderful, great people like you to make those kinds of decisions. I would like to say this. I do think there's hope. In 1986, Chief Justice Rose Byrd in California was defeated because of a decision that she made about the death penalty. 1996, Justice Penny White out of Tennessee, defeated also for the very same reason. 2010, three justices in Iowa defeated because the big money came in, and there they went. 2012, about $4 million was spent on one race in North Carolina because the party balance was at play on our Supreme Court. Tennessee and North Carolina in 2014, lots of big money came into those races for six justices, and we were all successful. People are disheartened and they're disappointed when they see shenanigans like this happening before on candidates for the Supreme Court of North Carolina. And across the – don't think this is just one state. It's happening everywhere. The great news is that people are becoming more aware. And once they know, they really don't fall for the big money solutions. They really do want to know more about the candidates. They want to know about a person's record, and they really do want to see that judges are committed to being fair and impartial and not that they come to the court with an agenda. That's great news.
Okay, I'll go to Justice Loughry. Both of our questions, what kind of scandal, if any, if you think, in your opinion, would it take, and what are the odds that Citizens United will be overturned? I have to sharpen that question a little bit. When? Because I'll say it's 100% that it will be overturned, but look how long Dred Scott was on the books.
Right. That's right.
So the question is when?
The question is, Justice Beasley and I are not going to make a lot of specific comments. We're in a bit of a different situation from others as judges, but I will say that can it change? Certainly, but it will have to be with a different makeup on the court. I mean, that is just that simple as far as that goes. As far as scandal, some of this is state by state. I wear a couple of different hats when I put together this book, and I went back decade by decade by decade. And, 1984 to 1981 in my state, we had 77 elected officials who were arrested and convicted of specific election violations, a huge thing. You think that would have changed things drastically, but it does make changes. You know, I'll be very brief. When I first went out and spoke to somebody, they said, "But things aren't the same as they were in the 1960s." And I said, "Yeah, but so what? You know, they're still bad. We still need to make these improvements." I do think we are, in many ways, in spite of Citizens United, I think we're moving in a positive direction. Look at the election right now. Regardless of who you're for or against, honestly, I think that the people looking toward Sanders, the people looking toward Trump, are really frustrated with everybody right now, frustrated with the entire system. Actually, I think that in some ways is a positive thing. I think people are more open to discussing these issues.
All right, Roger, we heard from you, so I'm going to hold you because I want to come back to you. But Dan, what kind of scandal? I'm going to give you the scandal question now, and then I'm going to pose a question to John on the Citizens United.
If hearing from an honest politician that up to 85% of his time was spent raising money is not a scandal, this is like boiling the frog by turning the heat up a little at a time. This is a full-fledged scandal right now. As far as Citizens United, I think it's purely a function of time. I think we can actually fix this where Citizens United becomes irrelevant. I really honestly believe that. Using technology and hitting the reset button and taking a fresh approach, rather than putting all of our attention on a constitutional change, I think there are ways we could expend less energy and fix this in a very creative populist, I underline populist, way.
John Bonifaz, what are the chances that Justice Kennedy will get so fed up and sickened by this open scandal that you have that he changes his vote, and flips in Citizens United? Is that possible?
I think it's possible. I think it's possible that Justice Kennedy did not foresee the SpeechNow.org VFEC ruling of the D.C. Circuit, which gave rise to the super PACs. I think it's possible that he didn't foresee the impact on judicial elections. When you look at some of the rulings coming out of the court dealing with money in judicial elections, they're far different than the way they've treated the question of money in legislative elections. So I think that's possible. I also think it's possible there are going to be vacancies in the foreseeable future that will change the composition of the court. But I also believe, as my opening remarks indicated, that it's possible to amend the Constitution. And that is why we have the power under Article 5 of the Constitution to do it. I'm not suggesting that we only do that, Dan, with all due respect. It's not a suggestion that we only focus on a constitutional amendment. But we cannot give up that power when we are faced with this kind of egregious ruling and beyond Citizens United, Buckley v. Valeo, which set us on this course of unlimited campaign spending. I also wanted to answer the scandal question, so I'll quickly do it, which is I appreciate
I've been trying to control Bonifaz since we went to college together and failing for four decades.
I appreciate the point that Fred's making about the importance of scandal, but I also think we have to take a long view here and look at history. Scandal is not what made the change for women to get the right to vote. Scandal is not what brought down Jim Crow. It sustained people's movements that make these changes, and that's what we have to build. And maybe it'll take 10 years, maybe it'll take 15, maybe it'll take longer, but the long view is that history is on our side.
And the new technology, as Dan points out, makes it more, those people movements have more potential power and more rapid power than ever before.
Well,
so, Fred, what
I,
kind of...
I do take...
Say whatever you want, Fred. I've forgotten the questions.
I've been doing this for 40 years, so I do take the long view. But if you look at Watergate, that led to the 1974 campaign finance amendments. If you look at the soft money scandals in the 1990s, that ultimately led to the McCain-Feingold bill. Scandals matter here. Now, on your point, this is beyond scandalous already, but it doesn't work in terms of triggering what has to be triggered. You need transactional scandals. You need the equivalent of the sale of government positions for money. You need criminal convictions. You need concrete examples that people can grab a hold of and say, I'm not taking this anymore. Basta. On the Supreme Court, I'd say there's zero chance that Justice Kennedy will change his views. I agree with Norm 100% that this decision will be overturned, and it will be overturned most likely when we get a different five to four on majority on the court. So it could happen at any time. It could take a long time. Many of us in this room may not even be here, but I would guarantee that this decision is going to be overturned. It just doesn't have any constitutional grounding.
What Fred means is we may not still be here in this room, despite the length of our program today. When Rosa Parks started the bus boycott, she had much less power and influence than anybody on this stage, most anybody in this room. And that first group that organized and said, hey, what about that pastor, Dr. King, to lead our effort? They had far less influence, control, visibility than all of us do. And if we take that spirit of indomitability, I do think, to answer your question, Citizens United will fall. I do think that what we're hearing is the different ingredients today, that the ingredients are there, that the pot is bubbling already faster than people may realize. Many think, oh, it's a hopeless cause. It's not a hopeless cause. We have the elements. We're looking for the catalyst. I believe one possible catalyst is a quid pro quo scandal. So it's not enough to have the legal spending. It shouldn't be legal. It's not enough to have the legal spending. You've got to have a quid pro quo. One of the classic, to Tim Wirth's question on the earlier panel, one of the classic elements of the quid pro quo is often the revolving door. So if you look at the Abramoff scandal, which helped stimulate the ethics reforms most prominently in the House, there was an element of people riding the revolving door. My friend Craig Holman is here in the audience, who's an authority on this. And that is often an aspect of these scandals. So that is one thing that we would look for. The scandal matrix has very decided, relatively simple. People give money. They want things in exchange for the money. And so I think that that is one like the spark of lightning striking the primordial soup and giving rise to life. That is one potential lightning strike in these very, very vibrant ingredients that the panel and the audience has laid out. Mike Peabody, over to you. And we have a, we'll pair your question with this gentleman's question over here.
Okay, well, my question was, what are we going to do about hard money? And I think that's been very much answered by this group. So what I wanted to do is just to comment on something, because I belong to the same club as Justice Roberts, and I saw him there about 2 years ago, and I was introduced to him. Found myself next to him in the soup line shortly, and I said, Justice Roberts, I want to congratulate you on the Citizens United decision. Oh, really, he said. I said, yes. It's angered so many people that I think we'll eventually solve this problem. And I think, indeed, today we are making good progress. Now, I might add that the time...
The cure may be worse than the disease, however.
What did he say? He didn't say it in front of me.
He said, you got to get that guy out of our club.
But I wanted to point out that I'm more and more impressed with the history of this situation. And Trevor was very good about talking about the history of the TR time. But I'm even more impressed with the fact that we fought a revolution over this very same question. It was George III with the Stamp Act, which erased effectively our consent to govern. And it took us 13 years from 1763 to be able to come to the Declaration of Independence. Well, we're on year six with Citizens United. We may have 7 years more to go if we do this in the historical fashion. But I think we're going to get there. It's going to take time.
Okay. May I see other hands of those who want to comment? Yes.
This is
next.
Scott Greatsack from Justice at Stake. It's good to see judges on the stage. I'm curious, even under public financing systems for judges in Wisconsin and Justice Beasley, obviously North Carolina, about 85% of total spending came from outside organizations. What do you think about the merits of an appointive system, a merit selection system, that half the courts in our country are currently using?
You want to go first?
I think you make a really good point. I don't know if the issue is whether we are appointed or elected. Now in North Carolina, after my election in 2014, this year we will have retention elections only for the Supreme Court. The Court of Appeals will still run regular statewide elections. However, the Court of Appeals is the only court which will now run partisan races, but the other courts will not. But the issue, I think, even with retention elections, is if there is now outside money coming into elections, in some ways that endangers the candidate more that you have a retention election, because you don't have a candidate to name that you're actually running for against, and so it's harder to raise money. You can't go to people and say, well, I kind of think that something's going to happen, and so will you help me? I mean, that's just not going to fly. And so it's going to be really difficult to figure out how that's going to work out. But I think knowledge is power, and the more people know about the importance of the role of judges in their everyday lives, because we are a third co-equal branch of government, and most people just don't even realize that. The more people know that, and the more people realize that so many of the legislation, the cases that come as a result of legislation being passed, come directly to state Supreme Courts and not to the U.S. Supreme Courts. Do y'all see the statistics about people think that Judge Judy's on the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court's frightening? But I think so. The more that people know, the better I think we are. But frankly, I've had the benefit of being appointed and then therefore elected, and then just straight out elected. And so that piece, I don't know if there's all of this millions of dollars. That's the real issue. Retention election, Florida, Tennessee, you've seen it. I mean, they have retention elections in those states. Iowa, retention elections. But millions of dollars being poured in, it's just hard to combat that when your judicial candidates are competing against presidential candidates, U.S. senatorial candidates, and these races are just not that sexy.
They're not that sexy, but they're very, very important. First of all, Judge Judy's not on the Supreme Court, but you learn something every day. I will tell you this. I've looked at this issue. I've thought about this issue a lot, and states have struggled with this issue since the Declaration of Independence. And if you go back and look historically, you'll see how states have gone from appointment to election to appointment to all kinds of different ways to do things. And it's almost like the gentleman that went to the small town one day and he said, there are only two places to eat. Where should I eat? And the storekeeper said, well, you can eat at one, but you're wish to heck you'd eaten at the other. And so, you know, states can figure out how they want to do that. And with regard to my election, I can tell you the amount of money from out of state, it was zero. And every single, with regard to me, that is, with regard to my election, every campaign donation that, and judges aren't allowed to ask for the money in my state, so I had to have people on my behalf do that. The contributions were from $1 to $100, okay? And they had to come from registered West Virginia voters. So that was something else that happened. And I can tell you the freedom, you just can't imagine this. We have a decision coming out in a couple of days. It's a huge decision in our state, and it will impact things drastically. And I can tell you the freedom to sit on that court for 12 years, and there aren't multimillionaires calling me to say, you need to vote this way because remember when I held that fundraiser? Remember? It just didn't happen. So.
Okay, Roger, I promised I would come back to you. I was saving you for one of these questions because of the engagement of the legislative branch with the judicial. Do you have a view? Feel free to hold.
Because in my other life, I practice law. So I'm a lawyer and a politician, and on weekends I'm going to sell used cars and go for the trifecta. But I grew up in a state where we don't have, I can't imagine living in a state where judges are elected. And these are two obviously very fine judges. But the idea that I could call up, you know, the laws, the rules of ethics are so different in the legislature. People can lobby me. People can give me money. But the idea of a judge now sitting on a case where one of the attorneys was a major donor and a major campaign worker for him, as opposed to the woman on the other side who worked for his opponent, it just isn't a good dynamic, I don't think. And I have never been able to understand the wisdom of having elected judges. In Maine, and I suspect in other states as well, we've had good governors, we've had bad governors, but most every no comment on the current situation. but we, I think all governors, at least in my memory, have taken the power of judicial appointment extremely seriously, and accordingly we've had a real independent bench. I wonder, not in these particular cases, but in general, about how that you can maintain that with elected judges.
Well, just a very brief response on that. I can tell you that, I meet with the chief justices each year from all the states and the territories, and we have discussions about all this. Anyone who thinks that the appointment process, maybe not in Maine but in many places, anyone who thinks that that is not political, in fact, that can be among the most dangerous political selections that you're ever going to see. It just is. I mean, it's incredibly – who makes that choice? So the argument would be, would you like the voters of your entire state to make a decision, do we want this individual to be on this bench, or do we want one individual, coming back to the issues that are discussed here today, do we want one individual, one governor, who maybe had to raise millions upon millions of dollars to choose five justices on the Supreme Court in my state, 158 magistrates, 70 circuit court judges, and 45 family court judges. So it's not that simple, and trust me, there are issues on both sides of it.
Tag on just one little thing. I just want to say, too, that the impact of outside money in state Supreme Court races will also determine who is available to serve. Everybody will not be able to compete against that kind of money. And so we need to be cognizant that if not only if we want a fair and impartial and independent judiciary, But if we also want a diverse judiciary, we've got to really be cognizant of the impact of that kind of money.
Okay. Thank you. I love it as a longtime practicing lawyer. I love it when a justice asks me if she can add one more thing. That's a total role reversal. I have to tell a funny, since Mike told us his Justice Roberts story, I had the privilege when I was ambassador in Prague to have multiple visits from Justice Roberts and got to know him and actually invited him to stay with us in the beautiful ambassador's house in Prague. And he's a very he's a nice soup line friend, but he's a very congenial housemate, stayed with us for about a week. And I neglected to tell my other house guests who would be there for dinner. So we had Shabbat dinner, we had Friday night dinner, and my other house guests come in and sit down, and there Justice Roberts walks in the door. Boy, you should have seen the double takes. One of the kids said, "Mommy, that man looks just like Justice Roberts." Okay, back to the audience for questions. We have one from that gentleman back there, and we have one from this lady here in the gray scarf.
Actually, I don't have a question, but just a very brief comment. Tony Bielenson, a former member of Congress, on the issue of campaign finance legislation at the national level, I've always felt that the necessary ingredient is a president who goes to the country with this issue. If he or she uses the bully pulpit properly, then you can excite the 70, 75, 78, 82% of the people out there who are basically with us on it. I think it can only come, I think that groundswell of support, perhaps not can only come, but certainly will be helped along if a president speaks out on that subject, and we've never had that.
I do think that just by way of context, you have had strong words from President Obama recently in the State of the Union. Well, it's not precisely a posit, speaking about the fundraising fatigue, and of course he famously called out the Supreme Court, which had not, since I was in the White House at the time and was involved in the decision whether or not the president could express his feelings. We researched how many years it had been since a president had criticized the Supreme Court in the State of the Union. It had been decades and decades. But there could always be more, and I know our next panel...
Here, Norm.
Yes, Fred, but I'll finish my sentence before you exercise our privilege. I will say that our Nick Penniman, who's busily taking notes in the back of the room, I'll put in a plug for the next panel since we're winding down. We'll have one last question from the lady in the gray scarf after Fred speaks. We'll talk about another presidential prerogative, the executive order. But that's for the next panel. Okay, Fred.
With all due respect to Norm, President Obama has been a tremendous disappointment on the campaign finance issue. He's had 7 years to do something, to be proactive, and until now, he has failed basically to do anything to promote and push for campaign finance reform. He did address it in the State of the Union. He is talking about it now. They are looking at an executive order, but it's 6 years since Citizens United, and there has been no response. No active response from the White House on Citizens United. Tony Bielenson is right. We've never had a president who's taken this issue to the country.
Okay. Fred, I'm going to have a heated argument with you in the hallway afterwards. We'll be selling tickets, but the clock prevents me from doing it now. Okay. Yes. Say who you are, and we're giving you the last word.
Okay. I'm Cassidy Sharp. I work for a nonprofit that's a part of the Democracy Initiative. And I was curious, I think one of the panelists or interveners had mentioned that it's mainly business spending all this money. And if you really look into it, it's mainly energy and finance industry. So I'm curious if there are any solutions that are more specific to those industries when you have that corporate influence blocking urgent policy on an issue like climate change, solutions that are maybe a little quicker than a constitutional amendment.
It's a fascinating question, and it's what you get when you start looking at solutions very seriously, drilling down whether you can target industries. I'm going to give – we gave you the last question. I'm going to give the last answer to Dan Wolf, and then keeping us strictly on time, we'll take our next coffee break. Dan?
As a corporate person, which I don't generally say about myself – I don't understand why corporations involved in politics do not require a shareholder vote before taking a position. And we do have legislation in Massachusetts which would require that, not just disclosure. By the way, I think we're way overstating the effect of disclosure, because the fact is a lot of times people just don't care about disclosure. They're going to do it anyway. But I think a shareholder majority vote should be required before a penny gets spent on politics from a corporation. That's one step in the right direction.
Okay, Bruce, yes, the interveners have not had their fair share.
We've addressed the issue of the shareholder vote. And when we take a look at where the vast body of shares are held among institutional investors, the shareholder vote is not the way to go, because the shareholder vote from the large institutional investors will ratify what the company is doing. In our engagement with the companies where the companies adopt disclosure and accountability, I think we are seeing indications that that does bring
take this outside too.
Yes, I'm going to be on Dan's side in this debate with almost as much trepidation debating Bruce as I do when I debate Fred. But since I have Dan in my corner, I'll do okay. I want to thank the audience for your very stimulating questions. I want to thank the panelists for being disciplined in their timing and rigorous and creative in their answers. And I'll leave you with one final anecdote. When I arrived as ambassador in the Czech Republic, the worst problem in the country was corruption. And everyone said nothing can be done. And the embassy and I engaged with Czech leaders, and it was a Czech-driven thing, in NGOs. And back to the idea of voter engagement, these NGOs came up with the notion of doing a very simple one-page agreement where they would go to people running for office and say, will you support the following bills or not? They, lo and behold, when the dust cleared after the parliamentary elections, over 70% of those elected had signed that agreement. And those bills have been falling into place one after the other. It's not easy to get people to the honor of the agreement, but it's happened and it's had a transformative effect. It's a much smaller place, it's a smaller electorate, but it's an example from my personal experience and an international example of how the impossible can happen in just a few short years if the public, the people get behind it with good leadership. And that's what everyone in this room represents. And I look forward to welcoming you back now in 10 minutes to learn why the time is now. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. Good to meet you.
Was that? It was very nice to meet you. It sounds like your elections are a little different.